Hi everyone. In today's tutorial, I want to talk about how the primary bone-making cells, the osteoblasts, regulate the formation and activity of osteoclasts, the primary cells that absorb bone. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the Histology Wizard. So specifically today, I'll give an overview of the RANKL, RANK-OPG system, which is one mechanism through which bone remodeling is balanced with bone formation. Now, in bone, there are three major cell types: the osteoblasts, aka the bone makers, that are critical for forming bone, osteocytes, which are the mature bone cells that function as mechanoreceptors, among other things, and the osteoclasts, or the bone breakers, that are critical for breaking down bone to release calcium and phosphate and help in the ongoing process of bone remodeling. For more on these cells, you can watch my video on bone organization. Now, in healthy bone, there's a balance between bone formation and resorption, and between the activities of the osteoblasts, shown here in blue, and the osteoclasts, shown here in red. Now, changes in that balance do occur normally with bone remodeling and in response to changes in the body's need for calcium. However, bone pathologies often result from abnormal changes in this balance, and changes that tip the scale towards bone resorption, either by increasing osteoclast number and/or their function or activation, or by decreasing osteoblast activity or function or number. Today we're going to focus on one mechanism through which osteoclast numbers and activity are increased. So one of the ways that this happens is through this RANKL, RANK receptor, and osteoprotegerin system. Now let's explore how this system works. First, we need to get oriented. Here we have a section of bone with osteocytes, which you can recognize by their dendrite-like extensions. Next, we see our osteoblasts that are closest to the surface of the bone. Now it's thought that osteocytes are the initiators of some signal cascades. One cascade usually starts with the sensing of biomechanical changes in the bone matrix by these osteocytes. Sometimes they sense the cell death of osteoclasts. Also, they can detect low levels of calcium in the blood. And all of these things might indicate the need for calcium to be released from bone stores. In any event, the changes are followed by interactions and communication between osteocytes and osteoblasts. And that results in a number of different signals being released. These are primarily in the form of chemokine secretion. These signals are going to attract and affect osteoclast precursor cells. Now we know that osteoclasts are derived from bone marrow hematopoietic stem cells that give rise to myeloid and lymphoid precursors. So myeloid precursors, or stem cells like the one I've shown here, can further differentiate into macrophage or dendritic cell precursors. These then can differentiate into monocytes, macrophages, and dendritic cells. What they differentiate into all depends upon what type of signals they receive. Now, certain cells, like the one I've shown here, express the macrophage colony stimulating receptor, or MCSF receptor, and that can become stimulated by macrophage colony stimulating factor, or MCSF. And that's going to trigger their maturation into macrophages. Now, if these cells are also stimulated to express an additional receptor called receptor activator of nuclear factor kappa B ligand, phew, or RANK receptor, this is going to alter their fate and drive them into the osteoclast commitment pathway. So bottom line, the expression and activation of both of these receptors is going to mean that progenitors will now develop into osteoclasts. So it turns out that the RANKL, or RANK receptor osteoprotegerin axis, is the key regulatory system that decides whether this osteoclast differentiation occurs. And I want to look at how we think that currently happens in bone. Now here we have a monocyte or a macrophage precursor, and it's expressing those MCSF receptors. Osteoblasts are going to secrete MCSF when they are stimulated by an additional signal, TGF-alpha, which I'm not showing here. So osteoblasts are going to release this MCSF, and I've shown this here by these orange circles, and they will eventually bind to the MCSF receptor on this precursor cells. And that binding is going to initiate a cascade of events, And one of those events is that these precursors are now going to express a second receptor, and that's the RANK receptor, which I've shown here in green. And so at this point, we're going to consider this progenitor or precursor cell an osteoclast precursor. Now, where does the ligand come from to activate this RANK receptor? Well, most of the evidence suggests that the RANK ligand comes from osteoblasts, and there's some evidence that some of it may come from osteocytes as well. Now, that RANK ligand is going to eventually bind to the osteoclast precursor cells, and that initiates another downstream process and a differentiation process. And part of this process is that multiple osteoclast precursors will fuse together to form multinucleated cells that are still inactive at this point. But they will continue to differentiate, and they'll move to the bone surface where they'll further differentiate into their final form, and they'll eventually express the genes that will render them capable of bone resorption. Here I'm showing the bone resorption pit or Halship's lacunae or the resorption lacunae in white. Now, importantly, the RANK receptor, RANK ligand interaction is critical for osteoblast differentiation and maturation, and it also likely helps osteoclasts survive. Now, there are a number of different factors that regulate this process, and some of the important ones are parathyroid hormone, which stimulates the release of RANK ligand, among other things, vitamin D, and hypocalcemia, or a decrease of calcium in the blood. Now, I've just given you a brief overview of this RANK receptor, RANK ligand system, or RANKL system, but I've not talked about the third major component or regulator of this process. So I want to come back to the interaction between membrane-bound RANKL and RANK receptor. It turns out that this is tightly regulated by the osteoblastic expression of another molecule called osteoprotegerin, or OPG, and this is a soluble decoy receptor that's a member of the TNF receptor family. So what's going to happen is that osteoprotegerin, or OPG, is going to bind that RANK ligand, and I'm showing the osteoprotegerin here in purple. And because it binds to the RANK ligand is no longer capable from binding to the RANK receptor. So in effect, with more OPG, fewer osteoclasts are able to differentiate and fewer are functional. And so that's going to tip that balance away from bone resorption. So again, these three components together, the RANK ligand, the RANK receptor, and osteoprotegerin form the key regulatory system which decides whether osteoclast differentiation occurs. So what this means is that the ratio between the RANK ligand and the amount of osteoprotegerin is critical to determine whether there's enough free RANK ligand available, free to bind the RANK receptor, act on those osteoclast progenitors to drive osteoclast formation. So osteoprotegerin expression then is also highly regulated, and many factors regulate its expression. So one of these is estrogen. And estrogen promotes the expression and the release of osteoprotegerin. It increases the amount that's available to block the RANK receptor. And remember, this means less osteoclast differentiation and fewer osteoclasts that are actually functional. Now, a lot of studies have shown that with increasing age and decreasing estrogen, osteoprotegerin also decreases, specifically in postmenopausal people. Now, not surprisingly, this decrease is linked to increased bone loss or osteoporosis. Now, what about negative regulators of osteoprotegerin? Well, one of these is parathyroid hormone. And parathyroid hormone actually affects the ability of osteoprotegerin to bind the RANK receptor. So now that means that more RANK ligand is available to bind to the RANK receptor, and this means a release of osteoprotegerin inhibition and a promoting of osteoclast differentiation. And that means we see increased function of osteoclast activity, which is again to resorb bone. So this makes a lot of sense, right? Because we know that parathyroid hormone release increases the release of calcium from bone. It's one of its primary jobs. We also know that it may act directly on osteoblasts to upregulate the release of RANK ligand. So it's helping promote osteoclast differentiation in two different ways. Now I want to end with a quick clinical pearl. Let's talk about a treatment called denosumab. So denosumab, and you may have heard of this, it's called Prolia. It's a human monoclonal antibody to the RANK receptor. I've shown it here in red. And it blocks the binding site for the RANK ligand. In effect, it's acting a lot like osteoprotegerin does in vivo. So denosumab is used for those with osteoporosis that are at high risk for fractures, for patients that have bone loss due to certain medications, and in those with bone metastases. Now, denosumab is contraindicated in people with low blood calcium levels. And this makes sense, right? We don't want to block the ability of osteoclasts to release calcium stores from bones in these patients. So if we're going to use denosumab to treat patients with low blood calcium or hypocalcemia, at a minimum, they're going to need calcium supplements. Now, to learn more about bone, check out my other videos on bone development and bone organization and formation, as well as my video on hematopoiesis to learn more about bone marrow. Thanks for stopping by.